Alright, so in the last class we were looking at the basic structure of the CMOS inverter, and we started the analysis, right? How we can go about finding the behavior of the inverter for different values of input voltage. Now the reason why this is important is because in the ideal situation we would only care about the performance or how the inverter behaves at the two ends, right? When Vin is equal to 0 or when Vin is equal to VDD. However, we are dealing with a practical system over here, which means that it is possible for the voltage to lie somewhere in between 0 and VDD, and even for that we want to know what the behavior is going to be like, because it can have an impact on other design criteria. Okay. So what we saw was the structure looks like this. There is a PMOS transistor and NMOS transistor, both their gates are connected together. The source of the PMOS is connected to VDD. Source of the NMOS is connected to ground. Vin is applied at the common gate terminal. Vout is taken at the common drain terminal. Okay. And what does this VTC, the voltage transfer characteristic, look like? VO versus Vin, right? When Vin is equal to 0, the NMOS is completely cut off. The PMOS has got a heavy VGS across it, right? So VGS minus VT is large enough that there a channel is sure to be formed. Whether it is saturated, linear and so on depends on the VDS value, right? So the VDS value is VDD minus VO, that keeps on sort of reducing, assuming that, you know, this is a situation where initially VO is low. What we are saying is that VO will keep on increasing. As long as there is a non-zero VDD minus VO, there will be current, and only when VDD minus VO finally goes to zero will the current completely stop. Okay, which means that the sort of steady state value you can expect for VO is VO equal to VDD, right? Similarly, when Vin is equal to VDD, the opposite happens. At that point, the PMOS transistor is cut off. Okay. No current can flow through that, therefore the NMOS will keep on reducing its VDS until finally the VDS across the NMOS becomes 0, which means VO is equal to 0. Okay. So these are like two segments of the voltage transfer characteristic. This essentially goes until the point VI is equal to VTN, the VT of the NMOS transistor, and from the point VDD minus VT of the PMOS transistor up to VDD, we find that the output voltage is going to be 0. Okay. Now, what are the sort of regions of operation, right? I had made an error in discussion in the class. I sent out an email about that. But anyway, we'll go through it in step by step now once again. Okay. So the first thing over here is in this segment, right? What can you say about the NMOS transistor? It's cut off, right? Because the voltage across a VGS is less than VT, so it's definitely cut off. As far as the PMOS is concerned, it has a large VGS across it, right? But the VDS is small in this region. In fact, it is zero effectively, right? Still, as far as the region of operation is concerned, the most accurate one that we can say is that it is in the linear region, because the moment VDS changes from 0, it's going to start conducting according to the equation we derived in the linear region, right? So it sort of makes sense to say that PMOS is in the linear region, right? Once the input voltage crosses VT of the NMOS, some current will start flowing through the NMOS transistor, right? And effectively what we will have is, we will have some kind of a current balance, right? Whatever current is flowing through the PMOS, the ID of the PMOS, we usually just call it ID, although normally it should be the IDS, right? The drain to source current. For the PMOS, the source to drain current, in general, without loss of generality or without causing confusion, we can just call it ID, okay? Should be equal to the ID of the NMOS transistor. this always holds, right? Because we are considering a static analysis of the inverter, right? Whatever current is flowing through the PMOS also has to flow through the NMOS. We are assuming that there is no other resistance through which part of that current can flow. Now, during a transition, when the input is actually changing from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0, you will find that there will also be a current going into the load, right? So, out of that VO terminal, right? Where does it flow? Usually into some capacitance. But as far as that is concerned, we consider that case only where the capacitance essentially, you know, is the situation where there is a dynamic behavior. That is, the voltage is continuously changing. There is a dV by dt. Therefore, there is a current through the capacitance. Under static DC conditions, there can be no current through a capacitance. Therefore, IDP has to be equal to IDL. We will use this for some of our derivations as we go forward. Okay. All right. What happens as I increase this? Now that the NMOS has started conducting, some voltage is going to drop across the NMOS, right? Which means that the voltage across the PMOS is no longer going to be equal to VDD. Or rather, the VDS across the PMOS is not going to be equal to 0. It will be something slightly higher than 0. Across the NMOS, there is a fairly large VDS. But that does not help because the VGS minus VT is very small. So, the amount of current it can sustain is still pretty low. Okay. Anyway, it starts dropping away like this. Right. In this region, what we can say is, what about the PMOS? It still has a high VGS minus VT and a low value of VDS, right? So as far as the PMOS is concerned, we can pretty much safely say it is still going to be in the linear region, okay? What about NMOS? What is the situation across the NMOS transistor? I have an NMOS transistor. This is the gate, this is the drain, this is the source. We assume the bulk is at ground. In this case, the source is also at ground. Okay. VGS minus VT is small because VGS has just gone above VT. VDS is large. Okay, and VDSAT is somewhere in between. So if I look at that level 1 combined equation that I wrote, effectively we are considering a situation where VGS minus VT is the smallest of these three quantities. As far as we are concerned, essentially what that means is that the channel has formed, it can take some current, but because of the VDS being large, it has also pinched off. So we are in saturation. Okay. So that's essentially what we see over here. NMOS is in saturation. Okay. After some time, as I still further increase this, right, the VDS across the NMOS keeps on increasing. Or rather, the VDS across the NMOS, sorry, keeps on decreasing. Right? More importantly, the VGS minus VT keeps on increasing. At some point, the NMOS could either remain in saturation or it might go into velocity saturation if the VGS minus VT goes high enough. Okay. For the time being, I'm just going to ignore velocity saturation. Okay. But it's quite straightforward to pull that in also later. Right. The important point is, as far as the NMOS is concerned, now we can, if we ignore velocity saturation, we can just say that, you know, it continues to be in saturation. Right. VGS minus VT is increasing. But on the other hand, the VDS is still large. Okay, so of the two, VGS minus VT is smaller. Therefore, the NMOS remains in saturation. The important question is, what happens to the PMOS as we go into this region of operation? Right? I am claiming that this is what the curve looks like. It's up to you to sort of verify that for yourself by actually plotting it, probably using SPICE or something like that. Right? But assuming that the curve looks like this, what happens over here in this region? The NMOS remains saturated, right? Because VGS minus VT is not very large. VDS is still greater than that. Okay. The PMOS, on the other hand, now what happens to it? As far as the PMOS is concerned, the VGS minus VT is going on reducing. For the NMOS, the VGS minus VT is increasing. That immediately means that for the PMOS, the VGS minus VT is reducing. Okay. Eventually, VGS minus VT becomes smaller than the VDS. What is the VDS? VGD minus VO. VO is reducing. So VDS is increasing, VGS minus VT is decreasing. So the PMOS is definitely going to move away from linear region towards saturation. And that is in fact what happens over here. The PMOS is also saturated. Okay. Eventually, we continue with this, and at some point, once again it starts tailing off, right? We find that there is one region over here where the NMOS now is seeing a large VGS minus VT and a small VDS, because the VDS has kept on dropping and now has essentially become small enough so that we can say that the NMOS has gone into the linear region. Okay, so here the NMOS is in the linear region, PMOS continues in saturation. And finally, when the input voltage crosses VDD minus VTP, what happens? Over here, the NMOS remains in the linear region, but the PMOS is now cut off. Okay. Now, the only difference that comes about if we bring velocity saturation into the picture is that middle region, where we talked about the NMOS and the PMOS both being saturated, most likely we will find that they are actually velocity saturated and not saturated. Right? So what's the difference between velocity saturation and saturation? In the regular saturation, we are talking about the channel getting pinched off due to high enough VDS. But in velocity saturation, we are saying even before the channel pinches off, the current saturates simply because my velocity of my electrons or holes cannot increase beyond a certain point. Okay, so it's just a sort of qualitative difference between the two. In both cases, the current saturates, it stops increasing any further and becomes sort of independent of the VDS. Okay, so this sort of tells us what are the different regions of operation that the transistor is going to, that the two transistors are going to go through as we sweep the input voltage. Okay, that helps us to derive a few things about the behavior of the CMOS inverter, right? In particular, one of them is something called the midpoint voltage. Usually referred to as BM. Okay? So if I graphically want to explain what the midpoint voltage is, it's just this. I have this voltage transfer characteristic. I plot a line over here which basically says Vi is equal to Vo, or Vo is equal to Vi, right? 45 degree slope. Wherever this hits over here, this point is called Vm. And of course, what that means is at that point, Vo is equal to Vi, so both of them are equal to Vm. Right? Now, first question, ideally, what would I like the value of Vm to be? VDD by 2, right? Just out of a symmetry consideration, if not anything else, right? So just from the symmetry point of view, I would like Vm to be equal to VDD by 2. Of course, that's also reflected in the name midpoint voltage, right? The question is, for a given inverter, which is constructed of a pair of transistors like this, how can we estimate Vm? Right? So how would we go about doing that? If I asked you what is the value of Vm for a CMOS inverter, how would you calculate it? Right? Exactly. So go back to this schematic. this is VDD, this is VM, this is also equal to VM, right? This is a static characteristic, so I have applied VM at the input, I am seeing VM at the output, I am not changing anything, right? Both transistors are going to be on, in particular according to this figure that I drew over here, most likely both are going to be in saturation, right? So that's good to know. What that means is I just have to equate the currents. What is the current flowing through the PMOS? What is the current flowing through the NMOS? If I equate those two, then I should get an equation which sort of gives me VM in terms of the other quantities, VDD, VTN, VTP and so on. Okay. So let's write down the equations. Of course, I am interested in the magnitudes of the current, so I am going to sort of leave out all the signs and so on and write down straight away the magnitudes and equate them, right? Remember always that when you are doing the actual calculations, you need to keep in mind that VT of the PMOS is negative, the VGS of the PMOS will actually be a negative quantity, right? VSG is what is going to be a positive quantity, right? So all of those signs you need to take care of. Right now I am ignoring all of those and just writing it down in a way which is sort of easy to understand, but please do not get confused about it while actually applying the equations, right? I am going on repeating this because there are a number of cases where you flip a sign, get completely wrong answers. So please be careful when you are doing that. Okay. Alright, so what's the magnitude of IDP going to be? What would be the equation governing this? Let's ignore velocity saturation, right? Continuing with the same thing. Huh? Saturation equation, so mu P C ox is the same whether it's P or N. WP by LP into VGS of the PMOS minus VT of the PMOS whole square by 2. Okay. So mu P technology constant, WP LP design parameters, COX technology constant, VTP technology constant. What is VGS? VDD minus VM, right? VDD minus VM, in this case VM is equal to VM, so I can put VDD minus VM, right? This is the condition that I am interested in. Okay, once again VDD is also known, so effectively I reduce this to a complete equation relating known terms to VM. Okay, and of course IDP is also unknown, right? So IDP and VM are two unknowns over here. Similarly, write down IDN. This is going to be equal to mu n C ox WN by LN into VGS of the NMOS minus VT NMOS squared by 2. And what is the value of VGSN? VM, right? VGS for the NMOS is equal to VN itself. So in other words, it's equal to VM over here, right? So I plug that in. What do I end up? I have two equations, IDN in terms of VM, IDP in terms of VM. And how do I combine them? IDP is equal to IDN, okay? So equate the two sides. And let's simplify this a little bit, right? I'm going to define one term R such that R square is equal to mu t w t by L t divided by mu n w n by L n. Okay, just to make the computations a little bit simpler, right? So that basically means I put in r square on the left hand side, right? Take that mu n c ox w n by L n to the left hand side, divide. Okay, so I get r square into VDD minus VM minus VTP the whole square by 2 is equal to VM minus VT the whole square by 2. By 2 is also I cancel out. So overall, I'm going to get something which looks like r square into VDD minus VM minus VTP the whole square is equal to VM minus VTM the whole square, right? I'm going to take square root on both sides. You need to be a little careful while doing this. Of course, you know that how, you know, the problems that can arise with quadratic equations. Once again, the sign. But I'm, you know what is happening over here, so you can keep track of that, right? So R VDD minus R VM minus R VTP is equal to VM minus VTM. Okay, combined terms, VM into 1 plus R equals R VDD minus R VTP minus VTN, or VM is equal to R by 1 plus R into VDD minus R by 1 plus R VTP, sorry, this should be plus VTN, plus VTN. Okay, what do we know about the parameters that we have here? VDD of course is around 1.8 volts for the technology that we are working with, right? R we do not know yet. We have to sort of get a value for R that is in our control to some extent, because I can change the WP and WN values. Okay, so now I need to choose a good value for R. What about VTP and VTN? What are the typical values? Around 0.4. If you would have done that simulation exercise, you should have got a VTN and VTP somewhere in the region of around 0.4, right? Now that's not magic. It doesn't, you know, it's not automatic that somehow VTN and VTP turn out to be the same. They are actually controlled by the process, right? So there is some degree of control that you can exercise over the VTN and VTP, usually by means of some ion implants or something like that during the processing stage. And intentionally, they make VTN and VTP both roughly equal to around 0.4 volts. That's sort of considered a good value to work with. Okay. As far as we are concerned, the good part is VTN is approximately equal to VTP. Okay. There's a 1 plus R dividing the VTN as well. Okay, so now if VTP is approximately equal to VTN, right, let's look at this equation and see what happens if I choose R is approximately equal to 1, or R is equal to 1. What will happen when R is equal to 1? VN will be equal to 1 by 2 into VDD. Minus 1 by 2 into VTP plus 1 by 2 into VTN. Right? Which means that this part of it effectively is going to be small, or at least much smaller than VDD by 2. Okay, there will be some difference between VTN and VTP. They will not be identical, but the difference between them is going to be much smaller than VDD. Okay, so I can sort of neglect this, and essentially I would get VM is approximately equal to VDD by 2 if R is equal to 1. Okay, So this is a useful piece of information for us. Essentially what it's telling us is, how do I make the midpoint voltage sort of go through the midpoint, that is VDD by 2. Choose R equal to 1. What is R? It's this parameter mu p W p by L p by mu n W n by L n, right? Or square root of that. Now here, typically, LP and LN you do not mess around with. Right? They are almost always kept at the minimum length. Right? In fact, for most digital designs, you will find that the lengths are pretty much kept at the minimum, always. It's only the widths that are changed. Okay. So what does that mean? It essentially means that mu p w p by mu n w n should be equal to 1. Or in other words, w p by w n is equal to mu n by mu p. Right? How much is mu n by mu p? In the case of the 180 nanometer technology, approximately 2, somewhere between 2 and 3. Okay? For our purposes, we will take that ratio to be 2. Right? So what this is telling us in other words is, if I choose my transistor sizes such that the PMOS is twice as wide as the NMOS, I should find that the midpoint, right, where the voltage transfer characteristic sort of switches from on to off, right, or from high to low at the output, pretty much passes through VDD by 2. Okay? But the question is, how sensitive are we to that? Right? Does it need to be exactly 2? What happens if I have 2.5? What happens if I 3? What have 3? What happens if I have 5? Right? As that ratio. Right? So in other words, this R value, instead of being exactly equal to 1, what if it varied quite a bit from there? Right? Now it turns out that the moment you start varying R from 1 significantly, then those equations also break down. You are not actually applying them in the correct way. Right? We assumed saturation, we applied the equations. What you always need to keep in mind is, whenever you do that, when you are asked to, let's say, find out what is the region of operation of a transistor, what you need to do is, in a lot of cases, especially for inverters and so on, you might have to assume something. It looks as though it should be in saturation. So I will assume it's in saturation, apply that equation, calculate all the voltages, check whether they make sense. Because if you calculate something and it tells you that no, this should be in the linear region and not saturation, it means that your initial assumption was wrong. You need to go back, fix that, check once again whether it is correct. Okay? In this case, for reasonable values of R, the assumption is good enough. It turns out that, you know, you can assume they are in saturation, they will come out like this. Right? But what happens if I do not have R equal to 1? What do you expect qualitatively is going to happen to the voltage transfer characteristic? VO versus VI. The endpoints are going to remain the same, right? This is the sort of voltage characteristic, voltage transfer characteristic when R is equal to 1. What happens when WP by WN is greater than 1? What would you expect is going to happen to this? Why to the right? But there is also some other VTP, VN term and all that, right? Is it obvious that it is going to shift to the right? Think about it qualitatively rather than in terms of equations. What you said is correct, right? So his answer was that when R becomes greater than 1, in other words, when WP by WN is greater than greater than 2 rather, right, the curve is going to shift to the right. What does that mean? It will look something like this. The endpoints have to remain the same, the cutoff points have to remain the same, but in between, the point at which it sort of starts dipping and moves will change. Right? Now, how can we see that qualitatively just based on what we know about the transistors so far? Why does it move towards the right and not, for instance, towards the left? This is also possible. Why should it happen that it moves towards the right? So think about it purely in terms of what happens when WP is larger. WP is larger means for a given VGS, VDS and so on, the IDP is going to be larger, or inversely, for a given IDP, the VDS that is required is going to be smaller. Why did this curve start shifting downwards as I increased VI? At some point the NMOS came on. At that point I had to equate currents, right? The IDP had to become equal to IDN. Why did it start dropping? Because now I need to have some voltage across the PMOS which can sustain that current, and that will be equal to the voltage equal to the current flowing through the NMOS. Now let's say the NMOS has remained unchanged, but the PMOS has become wider. What happens in such a situation? For a given amount of current, the PMOS requires a smaller value of VDS. So it will not come down as quickly, right? So this part of the curve will not shift down as quickly as it would have in the case where WP was equal to 2WM. So it shifts towards the right, right? And over here we have the other situation when WP by WN is less than 2. Okay. Now it turns out that if you actually plot this, you will find that it is not very sensitive. Right? You can sort of go even up to WP by WN equal to 10 or thereabouts. It will still look like an inverter. It will no longer, of course, be VM equal to 1.8/2. It will be maybe 0.9, it might be 1.1, 1.2, 1.3. It can increase quite a lot, but the rate at which it increases is not very fast. It's not very sensitive, in other words, to the WP by WN value. Okay. So why is all this important? Because what we will see later is we will choose WP by WN equal to 2 as our sort of default case, but not for this reason. The reason we choose is going to be more related to the currents that actually flow through the transistors and what is the sort of delay that you get as a result of that. Okay. In particular, one thing that is sort of easy to understand over here is, over here I have written the saturation equation. What happens if I consider velocity saturation instead? How would this have changed? What is the current equation? Mu P C ox WP by LP into VD sat P into VGS minus VT minus VD sat by 2. Okay. And let's say I go about equating the terms, right? Effectively what I will get is mu P C ox WT by LP into VD sat P into VVD minus VM minus VTP minus VD sat P by 2 should be equal to mu N C ox WN by LN VD sat N into Vm minus Vtn minus Vd sat n by 2. Okay. the Seahawks of course cancels out. Now what we have is mu p wp by lp into vd sat p by vd sat n. So that is what I need to take out as my r, right, if I am trying to sort of equate things over here. So effectively what I will do is I will define r as mu p wp vd sat p by lp divided by mu p mu n wn vd sat n by ln, right, and what I will get is r into VDD minus VM minus VTP minus VD sat P by 2 is equal to VM minus VTN minus VD sat N by 2. Right? I can once again simplify this and write down VM in terms of VDD, VTP, etc., etc., right? All the other terms. I group everything together. Right? What I will once again find is I want probably r equal to 1, right? R equal to 1 is what is going to give me a good solution in terms of Vm being equal to Vdd by 2, right? But r equal to 1 over here gives me a slightly different result, because Vd sat p and Vd sat n need not be equal. In fact, they will in general not be equal, right? Why is that? Because the whole current which is there in PMOS transistors typically saturates at a higher value of voltage, right? Because the holes have a lower mobility to start with. By the time they reach the velocity of saturation, right, it requires typically a slightly higher field. So very often what it ends up happening is that VD sat P typically is going to be higher than VD sat N. Okay? So WP by WN is no longer, in other words, just mu N by mu P. It is also related to the other VD sat N and VD sat P. Okay? But like I said, the final decision in terms of the WP and WN is taken based on other criteria, not based on this. Right? What it does tell you is, if you do need to design an inverter which has a given midpoint voltage, this is how you could go about doing it. Okay? Alright, so that's as far as the midpoint voltage is concerned. Now what happens, there's another parameter of the inverter which is also of interest before we get to the delays and so on, right? Which is something called the noise margin. Okay. So before getting into the noise margin of a CMOS inverter, let's sort of try and understand in a general terms, right, what do we mean when we talk about noise margin, right? One way of thinking about it is, if I just had a gate, right, how much noise can be tolerated at input before it affects the output, before output is affected. This is a slightly ill-defined statement, but it's possible to come up with a more sort of mathematically precise definition, right? What we do over there is we say, let's look at the voltage transfer characteristic for an inverter. Right? Now, the important part about this characteristic is, clearly I can say that this region is in some sense good. Right, and so is this region. Why am I saying that it's good? Because there's a significant amount of variation in the input voltage, but the output still looks pretty close to high. At the other end, even though the input is varying quite a bit, the output is still low. It's fairly close to the desired output, which is low. this intermediate region is the bad region. How can I, what's the best way to define that demarcation between good and bad so that it can be calculated rather than just sort of, you know, each person going and marking a different point and saying this is the border between good and bad. I couldn't hear anything that anybody said. How do you go about doing this? VTN is one possibility, right? So VTN is the point where it starts dipping. So clearly, as long as you have VI less than VTN, it is cut off, no questions asked. Similarly, VI above VDD minus VTP, cut off. But that's a bit too pessimistic, right? And it will also be problematic because if I look at other kinds of inverters, right, there are inverters where I do not have that proper cutoff happening at one of the two ends, right? CMOS is a case where either the NMOS or PMOS properly cuts off. I can define VDD, you know, VTN and VTP as my two boundaries. But let's say we'll look at later at something called the resistive load NMOS. You don't have that condition. In particular, when VI goes high, I don't have a point where the VO ever goes to zero. Okay, so that's going to be a problem if I use that as the definition. So instead, what we'll say is, look, the one thing about this bad region that I can say is, for any small change in the voltage or the input voltage, the output voltage changes by a much larger amount. Okay? So a small delta on the input voltage means a large delta at the output voltage. Mathematically, what is that? The slope is greater than 1. Okay? dVO by dVI. Magnitude, because it's actually negative, that the magnitude is greater than 1. Okay? For a given change in VI, there's a large change in the input output voltage. Now that gives us a clue. It essentially tells us that maybe one reasonable way of defining the margins where I'm sort of changing from good to bad is the point where the slope becomes greater than 1. Or in particular, where the slope is equal to 1. Okay? So we use that as the definition of our noise margin. And with that definition, we go forward and mark some specific points on that VTC. Right? What we say is, these are our two points of interest. This point, right, the left hand side point, the input voltage corresponding to that, I will call it VIL. Okay? It is the largest input voltage which is still seen as a low. Okay. Similarly, this other point over here, I will call it VIH. This is the smallest input which is seen as a high. Now correspondingly, when VIL is applied to the input of the system, what will be the corresponding voltage? It will be whatever is there on the y-axis, right? So this one over here, I call this as VOH. It is the smallest output voltage which is still to be considered as high. And similarly, VOL is the largest output voltage which is still to be considered low. Okay, so keep that in mind, it's sort of a reverse definition, right? I mean the smallest voltage which is considered high or the largest voltage that's considered low. These are the bounds that we are talking about. Okay, so these four terms, VIL, VIH, VOL, VOH, can be very precisely measured once you have the voltage transfer characteristic. Okay, and the noise margins are essentially defined as, let's consider the case where one inverter feeds into another identical inverter. What happens if I apply VIL to the first one, right? The corresponding output that I get will be VOH. Will that be seen as a proper input to the next stage, right? How much margin am I going to see? If I apply VIL at the first one, it will show VOH at its output, right? Which will be the input to the second stage. Okay? So in terms of noise margins, I want VOH to be greater than VIH, so that the second stage actually sees it as a proper high voltage. Okay? So the desirable thing is VOH minus VIH should be as large as possible. And similarly, VIL minus VOL should be as large as possible. These two quantities, VOH minus VIH, right? Looking at it over here, see VIH is somewhere over here, right? These regions marked in blue are the noise margins. Right? Graphically, what it's telling you is you want VIL to be large, and by definition, VIL will be less than VIH because of the way that we are actually marking those quantities. Similarly, VOL will be less than VOH, all that is fine. There is no guarantee that VIL is greater than VOL, but if it is not, it means that this is not working as an inverter. Right? So if VIL ever drops below VOL, it means that there is no input voltage which will be seen as a proper output low, or rather input low to the next stage. Okay? So VIL minus VOL must be as large as possible, VOH minus VIH must be as large as possible. In the ideal situation, VIH and VIL will both be VDD by 2, VOH will be VDD, VOL will be 0, the noise margins will be VDD by 2 in each case. Okay? So those are how the noise margins are defined. How we can sort of estimate them, we will look in the next class, right? Based on, again, similarly, you know, what are the things that we can do? Once again, equate currents. But in this case, we need to do something a bit more tricky to sort of estimate where that slope is going to be equal to 1. That's not going to be easy, so we'll have to do some other tricks in order to estimate that.